Tonight, ToonHeads takes a hard look at the worst cartoons ever. The bad ideas. The dreadful scripts.
Be cool. Be cool.
The shoddiest production.
Seize them.
The weakest characters. The atrocious backgrounds. The awful animation.
Come on, Slowpokes!
Tonight, ToonHeads presents the best of the worst cartoons ever. From the early 1960s through the late 80s, Saturday morning cartoons on the three major networks were the only place to see new animated cartoons from studios like Hanna Barbera, Ruby Spears, Filmation, and others. Grinding out hundreds of half-hour shows on low budgets with quick deadlines really took their toll on the creators. Not every series could be as original as Scooby-Doo or the Smurfs. In fact, new ideas were at such a premium that many Saturday morning cartoons seemed derivative of Scooby-Doo or the Smurfs. So where did the TV networks go wrong? For the answer, let's get to the root of the problem. When Scooby-Doo became a hit series in 1969, the networks clamored for more of the same. Hanna-Barbera created an assortment of variations on the Scooby-Doo theme. There were Scooby-Doo spin-off shows featuring Scrappy-Doo,
da-da-da-da-da-da! Puppy Power,
Scooby-Dum,
dum, 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 dum,
and Yabba-Doo. Then there were Scooby-Doo knockoff shows, and as you're about to see, nearly every detective cartoon had a Scooby-Doo wannabe. Unfortunately, most of these TV cartoon shows could never measure up to the original.
The Clue Club's on the scene!
You better believe it, boy!
Case in point, Goober and the Ghost Chasers, which premiered September 8, 1973. After a few episodes, it was felt that the Goober cast needed more help in the way of celebrity guest stars. The show was soon padded with regular appearances by the Partridge Family kids. In fact, they appeared in 8 of the 16 Goober episodes.
Are you the Partridges?
Yep, that's us all right.
The following year, the Partridge Family starred in their own cartoon show entitled Partridge Family, 2200 AD. Paul Winchell, who was best known as the original voice of Dick Dastardly.
Exactly as I planned it, right, Muttley?
Created the voice for the lead role of Goober.
He's just jealous of my talent.
A few years later, Hanna-Barbera brought Winchell back as another crime-solving pooch, Wolfer.
He knew it better than to fool around with old Wolf Tin Tin.
One of a pair of bloodhound detectives in Clue Club, which premiered on August 14th, 1976.
Sure, we do all the work, and they get all the credit.
Yeah, the work.
Credit.
Yeah, work.
Credit.
Yeah, we get it.
Like Goober and the Ghost Chasers, this Scooby-Doo knockoff lasted only 16 episodes before it was canceled. According to the Saturday morning programmers, the stereotypical animated teenager was interested in both crime-solving and rock and roll. Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid put these two elements together in a completely ridiculous package. This cartoon consisted of bubblegum music, a pooch named Elvis, Mickey Dolenz of the Monkees as the voice of Hank the Drummer.
That's weird.
It sure is.
And the band's robotic boss, Mr. Socrates, a supercomputer allergic to dogs.
Ha-ha-ee-choo! Get him out! Ha-ha-ee-choo!
The cartoon premiered on September 8, 1973, and only lasted 13 episodes. Of all the Scooby-Doo knockoffs, we have the most sympathy for Choo-Choo, a plucky pet from the Amazing Chan and the Chan Clan. Choo-Choo had to compete with 10 adolescent detectives, who were also a rock band, as well as relatives to the famous Chinese sleuth, Charlie Chan. Academy Award-winning actress Jodie Foster was the voice of young Anne.
Well, why should he only send boys? That's discrimination!
This series, which premiered September 9th, 1972, actually lasted two seasons before getting pulled. The two characters at the very top of the Scooby-Doo family tree are the most unusual, because though they act like Scooby, they were really machines. Wonder Wheels was a broken-down motorcycle.
This looks like a job for one
who turned into a zany dog-like super cycle whenever trouble beckoned. This cartoon was a segment within the show Skatebirds, which was a knockoff of the Banana Split show. If you thought Wonder Wheels was strange, it's hard to top Rickety Rocket.
Rickety Rocket, blast off!
A sci-fi Fat Albert Scooby-Doo clone with a comic relief retro rocket that looks more like a giant catfish than a rocket ship. Our teenagers, Cosmo, Venus, Sunstroke, and Splashdown ran an interstellar detective agency in outer space. This 1979 series was canceled after just 16 episodes. Here now is a sample of the classically bad Rickety Rocket.
Oh no! We're done for!
Definitely one of the best of the worst cartoons ever.
Far off in the future, a far-fetched mechanical miracle takes shape as a pile of junk turns into an out-of-this-world scientific marvel.
Rickety Rocket, blast off!
It's Rickety Rocket and the gang.
Cosmo.
Venus. Splashdown.
Sunstroke.
Let's take a look in
there. How come I always gotta go in first?
Okay, I'll tell you what. This time, I'll go in second.
That's better. How does he do that?
Stay close.
Monster catcher? Oh, ooh, that's my underwear!
Rickety, hurry!
Oh, wrong monster! I gotta save us!
From there. What's going on? What?
We ran into the monster.
Yeah, he went that way.
Okay, then let's go that way.
You hear that? Not me.
Now don't tell me you didn't hear it that time.
I sure like to.
It's coming from Mr. Blazer's room. Come on!
Rickety Rocket, blast off!
We'll return in a moment to the best of the worst cartoons ever. Welcome back to the best of the worst cartoons ever. Superheroes were always a favorite on Saturday mornings. Space Ghost, Super Friends, Birdman, and the Fantastic Four were just a few of the super good guys who kept the peace each week. But not every superhero was a gem. For example, take Turbo Team. Inspired by the talking car in Knight Rider.
I'll fire the turbo thruster!
Television executives decided to do the show one better by having a teenager actually turn into a talking car.
I'm gonna turn into Turbo Teen!
Sounds silly? It was.
It was a stormy night when a bolt of lightning forced me off the road. My car skidded into a government laboratory where a top-secret experiment was underway. I swerved into the path of Dr. Chase's molecular transfer ray, causing me and my car to become one. The incredible Turbo Team!
This cartoon premiered September 9, 1984, and not surprisingly lasted only 13 episodes. Take a peek at Turbo Team. Definitely one of the worst cartoons ever.
That's what you call one weird creature.
Talk about weird creatures, Alex. How do you think I feel? It's not easy being a super turbo-powered car.
No, but I can't think of a better way to get into a drive-in. Come back here, you hot dog napper! Uh-oh, ice cubes. Turbo Team's gonna get cold and change back into Brett. Hi there.
Alex, I wish you'd be more careful with your cold drinks.
A smidge higher and it's lined up.
By the 1960s, the Three Stooges had been transformed into an animated series.
Are you?
When television executives decided to bring them back to Saturday mornings a decade later, they turned them into superheroes by adding a dash of the Bionic Man.
Robotic Stooges!
Robotic Stooges, away!
Paul Winchell was used as the voice of Mo.
Why, you?
And Frank Welker created Curly's voice.
Me, Curly! You, apes!
Similar to the voice he used on Jabberjaw.
I am the roughest, toughest white shark ever!
This cartoon first aired January 28, 1978. It was an animated segment within Skatebirds, which only lasted 15 episodes. Like the Three Stooges, the world-famous comic basketball team, the Harlem Globetrotters, had been animated for Saturday mornings in the early 1970s. The team was brought back a few years later, this time with an unusual twist. As the Super Globetrotters, they became five outrageous characters who brought criminals to court. The basketball court. The show premiered September 22, 1979, and was canceled after just 13 episodes.
Stay away from that thing! You'll bring down the building!
Not with the way we handle the ball! Catch, Curl!
Fools! If you hold that core still, it'll heat up and deionize!
Really?
Oh! Take it, Lou! No problem, brother. We'll just keep the ball moving.
Oh, no! The power core!
This is what's called a fast break.
Stop! Stop! You're playing with disaster!
I thought it was a ball!
Dead end!
Droids, stop them!
Man, there's nowhere to go.
Nowhere but up. Ultiman, multiply!
Go, 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 geese!
Okay, climb on up.
Right on, geese!
I thought you'd never get here. We need a saw.
I got one here somewhere. Everybody relax. And I'll have you out of there in a jiffy.
Wow,
Fresh air. Now that's a real breakthrough.
Follow me, men.
Hey, what do we do with this thermal thingamabob?
Keep it moving.
Hurry, geese.
Here I come.
Do Spaghetti Man, Multi Man, and Liquid Man look familiar to you? All three characters were used a decade earlier in the cartoon The Impossibles. Note the incredible similarities.
Multi-Man!
Multi-Man, multiply!
And Fluid Man!
Liquid Man!
Oil Man!
Spaghetti Man!
Some cartoon ideas were so poor, you wonder how they ever could have been produced.
Huh? Wait a minute. Who are you? How did you get in my TV set?
One superhero takes the cake, Mighty Man and Yuck.
Close enough, eh, Double M?
This cartoon was about a miniature superhero.
Mighty! Mighty! Mighty Man!
And his companion, the world's ugliest dog.
He's a nice doggy, but he's got a face that'll stop a 10-ton tank.
Yuck always wore a doghouse over his head. This was obviously done to save time and money, so the animators wouldn't have to draw Yuck's face, and more importantly, his mouth. Now this cartoon is a candidate for the absolute worst ever. Mighty Man and Yuck premiered on September 15, 1979, and amazingly, 32 cartoons were created.
Up in the sky, it's the world's smallest superhero, Mighty Man.
Boo-boo-boo. Hi there.
And Yuck, the world's ugliest dog.
Hiya, folks. No! They don't make clocks the way they used to.
It's Mighty Man and Yuck.
That's us.
No! Yuck! Don't lift them!
I told you not to lift your house. It's the hotline. Yes, Mayor. Mighty Man here.
Some secret blueprints were stolen from the Mars rocket base. We suspect it was the work of Big Mouse.
Mayor, before you can hum boo 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 boo, we'll get the plans and capture Big Mouse. Okay, Yuck, bring out the Mighty Machine.
One Mighty Man coming up.
Mighty!
To the secret Mighty Cave!
Mighty Man, where are you? Hey, where'd you go? I was right behind you.
And now I'm right behind you. Yuck, peel me off so we can go on our assignment. Quick, Yuck, to the Mighty Cycle. Hold on, Yuck. Here we go.
We'll return in a moment to the best of the worst cartoons ever. Welcome back to the best of the worst cartoons ever.
Suffering catfish? What was that?
Some of the worst cartoons ever were based on the classics.
Let the ordeal begin.
When Hanna Barbera adapted Mark Twain's Huck Finn as a weekly primetime series, they placed live-action actors in a low-budget cartoon world. 20 episodes were created, and the show premiered on September 15, 1968. Perhaps the oddest thing about this show was they actually found a trio to play Mark Twain, Huck Finn, and Becky Thatcher, whose acting was as stiff as the animation. The live-action characters never seemed to truly interact with their animated co-stars. And the poorly executed special effects combined with bad storylines make Huck Finn one of the worst cartoons ever.
Thought I'd mosey by, see if you needed a lift ashore.
Then let's go, quick!
Trollkins was based on a different type of classic. It was not simply a knockoff of the Smurfs. The show combined Dukes of Hazzard car chases with Scooby-Doo plotline.
Bad dog! Bad dog!
It premiered on September 12, 1981, but was canceled after just 13 episodes.
What the troll? Hey, a troll, troll, troll!
What's the matter with Flukey? He's trying to tell us he saw a UFO.
Troll!
Why, that's troll-diculous. There's no such thing as a UFO!
It's a UFO, all right. Step on it, Blitz. We gotta warn Troll Town.
The Great Grape Ape was a giant purple primate who was a knockoff of Megilla Gorilla and King Kong.
Yep, that's me.
This oversized monkey rarely spoke, and when he did, he usually uttered the same two words over and over.
Grape ape, grape ape, grape ape, grape ape.
Only the Pink Panther had a more limited vocabulary.
Grape ape, grape ape, grape ape, grape ape.
The Grape Ape was teamed up with a certain cat and mouse in the Tom and Jerry Grape Ape Show, which premiered September 11th, 1975.
I'm sorry, Grape Ape, Grape Ape.
Back in the early 80s, Hanna Barbera attempted an animated laugh-in variety show. The program was called Joke Book. It was a rare attempt in those days at a primetime animated comedy series. The show's humor was definitely meant for an adult audience.
Hey, George.
Huh?
How was the party last night?
Great. I got stoned.
Oh. It premiered on April 23rd, 1982. And although 8 episodes were produced, NBC pulled the show after just 3 weeks. Five of the episodes never made it to air. Here are a few examples why. This next program is a trifecta of bad cartoons. Hey, It's the King was based on the Fonz.
Hey.
And each half hour contained two companion cartoons. Undercover Elephant.
Something less conspicuous.
Which was a poor imitation of Secret Squirrel.
We need some wheels undercover.
Coming up.
And Shake, Rattle, and Roll.
Yikes!
A ghostly version of the Three Stooges.
Ooh, ooh, ooh.
Saturday morning cartoons didn't just recycle classic novels, movies, and primetime series. Sometimes they preyed on their own. Blast Off Buzzard was a poor attempt to replicate the classic Warner Brothers Roadrunner cartoons. Just like Wile E. Coyote, Blastoff never gets his intended victim, Crazy Legs. The cartoon was part of the CB Bear Show, which premiered September 10, 1977. Only 13 Blastoff Buzzard cartoons were ever created. Here's a sampling why. Turn in a moment to the best of the worst cartoons ever. Welcome back to the best of the worst cartoons ever. When TV executives ran out of original animation ideas,
Partridge Pad,
they decided to adapt well-known pop culture characters to cartoons.
Now that sounds like a good idea.
Yeah.
These were known as pre-sold properties because the audience was already familiar with the characters. But there's a big difference between the original versions and these made-for-TV animated shows. Do you remember the cartoon version of Happy Days, Star Trek, Q-Bird, or the New Kids on the Block? How about Pac-Man?
Game win!
The cartoon Pac-Man was based on the popular video game that swept the nation in the early 80s.
Power pellets!
But the storyline of the cartoon made virtually no sense. Pac-Man became a family man living in Pac-Land, whose job it was to constantly guard the power pellets from the evil Mesmeron.
No!
And his ghostly assistants.
There he is!
Inky.
I got him now.
Pinky.
Here I come.
Blinky.
Geronimo!
Clyde. And Sue.
Oh no!
Blast off!
And unlike the original video game character. This Pac-Man wasn't silent.
Sure. Next time I take a ride like that, I'm bringing a parachute.
It featured the annoying voice of Marty Ingalls.
A chomp a day keeps the ghost monsters away.
Who had modest success as a sitcom star during the 1960s. His smoky voice gained him numerous roles in Hanna Barbera cartoons.
I'm afraid, my friend, we are going to have to find us a job.
Do you remember AutoCat and Motor Mouse? Ingalls created the voice of AutoCat.
Boy, oh boy, I got that Motor Mouse zeroed in now.
But Pac-Man remains his most memorable role.
Those were good, but I've still got the munchies. The Ghost Monster munchies.
Back power!
Richie Rich was the most popular comic book in America during the 1970s. There were 30 different titles on sale each week. Even his butler had his own comic book.
Time for lunch!
For Saturday morning television, the producers abandoned the original comic book premise.
We're getting closer!
And changed Richie into a young teenager who solved mysteries with his comic dog and robotic maid. Sound familiar?
What's that?
A
I'll give you three guesses.
I got it. Scooby-Doo!
It became yet another Scooby-Doo knockoff. The cartoon initially aired November 8, 1980, as part of the Richie Rich Scooby-Doo show. Richie's girlfriend, Gloria, was voiced by Nancy Cartwright, who went on to create the voice of Bart Simpson.
If Richie says his house is burglar-proof, it's burglar-proof!
Casper the Friendly Ghost was another comic book character. In September of 1979, he premiered in a new TV cartoon called Casper and the Angels. If Casper wasn't already dead, this series would have killed him for sure. The cartoon placed the little ghost 200 years into the future and partnered him with two female officers. It was an attempt to recreate the success of Charlie's Angels.
Now don't you worry, little one. We'll get along just fine.
But the series was canceled after just 13 episodes.
I'm not good at your ghost-type tricks.
Hanna and Barbera's original Tom and Jerry shorts won an unprecedented 7 Oscars for their superb animation, ingenious storylines, and excellent comic timing. Then, TV cartoons of the world's most famous cat and mouse duo were created for Saturday morning. And the pair haven't been quite the same since. First came the Filmation Tom and Jerry cartoons, which at least kept them mute and at war with each other. Then Hanna Barbera made their TV version.
Set your dial for a while, have a laugh, wear a smile, it's a Tom and Jerry show.
Which cast them as buddies. The mouse was even given an oversized bow tie. Tom and Jerry suddenly became a kiddie cartoon that was even too cutesy for young children. Which Tom and Jerry TV cartoons are worse? You decide.
We're friends now! Don't run, fellas! You've saved my life! We're friends forever!
That was bad.
Try again!
But not as bad as Filmation's version of Tex Avery's Droopy.
Gee, I guess Slick is right.
This cartoon gets our vote as the worst cartoon of all time.
Dum, itty, dum, dum, dum. Get down, get down.
The original voice of Droopy was created by Bill Thompson.
Hello, Joe.
Years later, Tex Avery provided the voice of the docile dog.
Hello, folks.
But in tonight's last cartoon, Disco Dog, the voice of Droopy was created by Filmation producer Lou Schemmler.
I'm here to get down and boogie. Doo-wah.
The disco fad had long been dead when this cartoon first aired in 1980. Here's Droopy in the worst cartoon ever, Disco Dog.
Hello, folks. I'm going to a disco contest. Whoopee.
Welcome to the opening night of the Slipped Disco, folks. And here to dance your hearts away, guiles, is none other than Slick Wolf heartthrob of millions and star of his own TV show, Dance to Stardom.
Well, it looks like you won't have any trouble finding a dance partner for the contest, Slick.
Yeah, there's enough of me to go around, Goyles.
And here comes another contestant. Oh, no, I was mistaken.
Sorry, pal. Delivery's in the rear.
Quite the opposite, sir. I'm here to get down and boogie. Do well. Well. Biscuit, cat's meow.
Hey, let the poor slob in. I need the laughs. Let's get the contest rolling.
All right, gang, clear the floor. The dancing is commencing, and Slick is the man to beat. All right.
Let's see now. Too thin, too tall, too big, too small. You're just right. Welcome to stardom, lucky lady.
Get lost, creep. I want to dance with him.
Oh, this is wonderful. Don't you think I'm cuddly? Oh, I like your disco feet. Ooh, wow, uptight. Doo-dee-dee-doo.
Come on. We'll dance him into the cellar where he belongs.
Gee, Slick's a hot dancer.
This should drop the little jerks out of the contest. Watch my fire!
Congratulations, Slick. When you're hot, you're hot.
Moving right along. The next number is a hot acrobatic disco number. Let's boogie.
Just call me Tricky Slicky.
Oopsie-daisy. Gee, Slick sure is slick at this sort of thing.
Don't worry, Droop. We're doing fine. Almost.
Hey, you're working up a ladder, Droop. Here, cool off a little.
Gee, thanks, Slick. Isn't Slick a nice person? I like Slick. Whoops! Dum-dee-dum-dee-doo-dee-da-da-da. Dum-dee-da, with a heart of glass, get down.
Why, that little runt. Come on, we'll show him. Okay, no more Mr. Nice Guy. Let's get down.
Uh-oh, folks. This is it. Slick's gonna have to give it his best shot. This is the big one, the solo dance between Disco Slick and Reary Dog.
That's Droopy Dog, thank you.
Slick isn't about to hand over the king of the disco title to Drippy Dog.
Droopy's the name, and dancing's my game. Dum-dee-doo, get down, get up, dee-dum-dee-doo. And may the best discoer win, Slick. Now that's what I call a gentleman, and this is what I call the table top leg.
The guy's impossible. Time for the Hidden Springs routine.
And Slick bounces back like a real pro. He's out dancing Hoosits by leaps and bounds.
Who's your little Hoosits? Droopy is his name. Dum, dee, dum, dum, dum. Get down, get down.
Yeah, that's right, Drip. You get down, get down. While I get up, get up. Oops.
Slick
fruity soda. Thanks, Slick. I needed that.
You're welcome! Oh, no!
I think it's time for a break, folks.
You know what, folks? I'm happy.
Although Disco Dog gets our vote as the worst cartoon ever, it proves that something good can come from something so bad. It was in this cartoon that John Crisfalusi, the creator of Ren and Stimpy, got one of his first breaks in animation. Note the John K. characters in the background of Disco Dog. A lot of great animation talent was held back during those lean years of the 1970s and 80s. But many of today's greatest cartoonists and writers cut their teeth on these shows.
Okay.
And many veteran animators spent their senior years gainfully employed because of these cartoons. The children of that era enjoy these shows and still have fond memories of them. So you see, they may be the best of the worst cartoons ever. But they still played an important and unforgettable role in the history of animation.